9/11 families, not limited to those who lost loved ones at the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. Dozens died in a remote field near the rural town of Shanksville, Pennsylvania. United Airlines Flight 93 crashing to Earth at hundreds of miles per hour. Hijackers had taken over the plane. The passengers got word at that point of the earlier attacks. So Todd Beamer led a revolt, charging the cockpit before terrorists could do any more damage. And he is among those who will be so prominently remembered. And David Beamer is his father, and he joins us now. Mr. Beamer, welcome. It is good to have you here today.
Thank you very much, Martha. Good to be here. It's been quite a week so far, huh?
It has. You know, first of all, sir, you know, what's your reaction? And tell me how you got the news and what you thought when you heard that bin Laden had indeed been killed.
My reaction was one of relief and satisfaction and happiness. He got exactly what he deserved. And of course, as the story unfolded, the skill and the courage of our intelligence agencies and those Navy SEALs, absolutely remarkable. And I am so thankful for them.
We all join you in that. Their story is just so incredible. And the president is going to meet with some of that team, you know, at the base in Fort Campbell, Kentucky tomorrow. Talk to me a little bit about your feelings about the president, because you've been at odds with this administration over a number of things, and very prominently over their initial decision to want to try KSM, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, and others in Lower Manhattan. It looks like you won that battle. So what's your response to how they're handling things now?
Well, Martha, with the glorious news of Osama bin Laden's demise at our hands, that was wonderful. I feel some chagrin now, though, about how the rest of it's being handled. And frankly, it started May Day 2011 when the president announced to all of us what had happened. The excessive use of the personal pronoun that he used in his remarks, I really felt that was the beginning of the commander-in-chief putting too much spotlight on himself, taking too much credit for what these remarkable Americans had done. And of course, it's only now been accelerated to a greater degree in the media. You know, it's being hailed as one of the greatest wartime decisions, bold and gutsy. And quite frankly, under the facts and circumstances, I think it was anything but that. I think this decision had an inexorable conclusion at the various decision points as the information unfolded were straightforward and easy and really had no other choice. Let's remember, some time ago, the intelligence agency comes to our commander-in-chief and says, guess what? We found him. We know where he is. He's in a very large compound, and you know what else? He's within almost spitting distance of the equivalent of West Point in Pakistan. So, Mr. Commander, what do we do? Well, the answer could not have been nothing, because eventually that word would leak. And it's one thing to let Osama bin Laden get away before 9/11, but you could never survive as Commander-in-Chief letting him get away after 9/11.
But what about the way that the decision was carried out? Because there was another option. They could have used a B-2 stealth bomber and dropped JDAM bombs on that whole location. But that would not have given anybody, you or anyone else, the satisfaction of knowing for sure that they got Osama bin Laden in that raid.
Well,
there would have been more collateral damage.
Martha, I think beyond that, how would the rest of the world, the Arab nations, and frankly the free world, react to the USA big bomber, big bombs, flying into a sovereign country in their airspace and lighting the place up right close to their West Point, and obviously more collateral damage on the ground? That would have been tough. It would have been a worldwide outrage to that sort of approach. So given the option, I tell you what, Mr. President, we have some technology and we have most capable men and women. They can go in there in a small raid, short amount of time, in and out, and the world will certainly understand that America could not let Osama bin Laden continue to live there in almost plain sight. And we can explain that kind of an action to our allies and to the rest of the world, no problem. And I think beyond that, the hard question of, you know, well, dead or alive. Well, I think the answer to that question was another bit of a dilemma, given this administration's stance on how we treat enemy combatants. Do we bring bin Laden back to Gitmo? Mm-hmm. Do we give bin Laden to Attorney General Holder. Both of those were tough kind of options. So I'll tell you what, the desired approach is bring them out in a body bag.
I hear
so
you.
If you think about those facts and circumstances, I think it was a decision that's clearly the right one, but I cannot put it in the category of the greatest and gutsiest and toughest decisions made in recent war times. And
right.
to use this decision as to wipe the slate clean and say, see what, our president really does have massive leadership skills and experience, and this proves the point.
Well, that, and no doubt, that point will be made by the president and by his supporters, and some will say it's justified, and you clearly feel that it is not justified. You know, what about today? You know, you have been one of the most prominent spokespeople and forward people for this group of victims for the 9/11 families. Deborah Burlingame has as well, and there are others. She chose to go there today and to meet with President Obama and speak to him. You were offered an invitation today and declined, correct?
That's true, Martha. That's
Why
true.
Why is that? Why'd you make that decision?
I don't know what would be gained by my going to a allegedly, a private meeting with no press with, 49 other folks. I'm just not
But if you had the chance you could be there face-to-face with President Obama today, what would you say to him?
I would say some of the things I've said in the past, that his policies of the war on terror, his practices is how we treat KSM, the fact that he has appointed Attorney General Holder to decide which things to prosecute and which ones not, I'm still in absolute opposition to his track record and proven policies. And by the way, what 40 Navy SEALs and the intelligence agency did in this wonderful and courageous event does not change what his demonstrated policies and practices have been.
All right. Thank you very much. David Beamer, you've been a fantastic spokesperson in your son's
Martha,
name and all the others.
Martha, one other comment, if I could just
sure, of course.
Make it. Much of what we do is, and I understand, is to reach out to moderate Muslims. And I guess the special burial at sea of Osama bin Laden was a case in point. I'm waiting to hear some senior moderate Muslim spokesman speak and say, indeed, Osama bin Laden was really an evil person and his demise is okay. And further to say that the treatment of him with an Islamic funeral was the right thing to do and we appreciate it.
Right.
I'm waiting to hear that.
I understand. And a lot of people share that sentiment. Thank you so much, sir. David Beamer, good to have you with us today.
Thank you.